Standard Chartered and CNBC TV 18 present India on the Move, the 21st Century Agenda, Season 5.
Hello and welcome to India on the Move, Season 5. I'm Ritu Bhandari. On the show today, we're talking about India's macroeconomic growth outlook. Needless to say, the last year and a half have been tough for nations as well as economies, particularly emerging economies like India. And as we try to move forward on the road to recovery amidst concerns about a next possible COVID-19 wave, there are questions to be answered. The first big one being, what happens to the India growth story from here on? To discuss this and more, I'm joined by very eminent industry experts here today. Let me welcome Jeremy Zook, Director of Sovereign Ratings at Fitch Ratings, Karthik Srinivasan, Senior Vice President and Group Head Financial Sector Ratings at ICRA, and Anubhuti Sahai, Head South Asia Economics Research at Standard Chartered Bank. Welcome everyone. Thanks very much for joining us here today. Well, recent times have been extremely tough for humanity as well as global economies. We are here today to discuss what the India growth story looks like from here on. Jeremy, I want to begin by asking you, you know, Fitch had revised its outlook on India's sovereign ratings a couple of months back from stable to negative, largely due to the public debt burden. What is the current outlook and the medium-term outlook looking like for India at this point?
Yeah, certainly. We did revise our outlook to negative on India's BBB- rating last June, and that was really to reflect a lot of these fiscal pressures that we were seeing arising from the pandemic. And we still have a lot of uncertainty, in our view, around the medium-term debt trajectory, and so that's why we still have a negative outlook in place. You know, on the growth front, we're a bit more positive on that. We saw, of course, a very large contraction last year, and relative to our pre-COVID forecasts, of course, India's GDP has taken quite a large hit. We're expecting by fiscal year 26 for GDP levels to be about 8% lower than what we had previously thought. But, you know, in the near term, we are expecting in the current fiscal year growth of 10%, and that comes despite the pretty severe public health crisis from the second wave. Over the medium term, we still have relatively strong rates of growth, and one reason behind that is India has a very large negative output gap at the moment, and so just faster growth rates will help to close that negative output gap. So for next year, we expect growth at around 8.5%, and then about 7% there on out is our average growth rate until fiscal year 8.5%, and then about 7% there on out is our average growth rate until fiscal year 26.
Right, absolutely. And perhaps relatively resilient is not a bad place to be in at this point in time. Anubhuti, you know, the sentiment was gradually beginning to turn towards recovery until the second wave really hit India. Now, consumption has, of course, been restrained owing to health and financial anxieties. We are already apprehensive about an impending third COVID-19 wave in this year. How much damage, in your view, can these successive waves of COVID cause to the economy in the short to medium term?
Thanks, Mridu, for the questions. So, our FY22 GDP growth forecast is at 8.5%, and it builds in another round of increase in infection in the rest of financial year 22. But it doesn't build in a third wave. In case if we are hit by a third wave, of course, the GDP numbers which we have at this particular juncture will face a downside risk. Having said that, if we look at the second wave in India and its impact on economic activity, and equally importantly, if we look at global experiences, there have been waves after waves in US. Currently, there is another round of increase in infection in US. China is also going through another round of increase in infections. It's pretty clear that the sensitivity of economic activity to successive waves is reducing gradually. Thus, our view is that we can see an adverse impact on growth recovery. The recovery can be delayed, but not derailed at all. So there will be an impact on growth, but not massively. The larger point here is, however, that in case if we are hit by third wave, and by chance yet another round of wave, I think what makes the recovery process, it becomes far more uneven than what it is at this particular juncture.
Right. Okay. So let me also get in Karthik at this point. Karthik, Anubhuti just spoke about, the road to recovery, especially led by large businesses and, what the SMBs are going through. Give us a sense of what the numbers are looking like on the lending and the credit side at this point. Has the pandemic really somewhat compounded the structural issues in the banking space? And if we do have a third wave, will the NPA cycle again see the kind of peaks that we've seen earlier?
Thanks, Anubhuti. Couple of things. One, the banking sector has been facing challenges even prior to the COVID onset. So there have been challenges on the public sector banks as far as capitalization levels and asset quality is concerned. The onset of COVID has only increased the overall risk from that point of view. What we have seen over the last couple of years is because of challenges on capital and increasing risk averseness amongst lenders, credit growth has slowed down to single digits for the last 2 years. It has also been compounded by the fact that capacity utilizations have been low and corporate sector has also been deleveraging and going slow thanks to the various challenges faced at the ground level. With substantial capital infusion by the government into public sector banks, with banks having already provided for a significant part of the legacy NPAs, private sector banks, though hit, are in a relatively better position, and they have also raised sizable capital over the last couple of years. So net-net, they are in a much better position today as compared to a couple of years back. But the uncertainty and the risk averseness has still not fully gone away. So we expect that the credit growth would continue to remain in single digits for FY22 as well. It would, as of now, we do expect that to be higher than the 5-odd% that we saw in 21. Our estimate is probably closer to 7-8% for this year. And in case the economy were to show signs of pickup in the second half, then you could see, closer to a 10% or higher growth in the next financial year.
Even amidst the uncertainties, we will keep the optimism up. I also want to talk a little bit about, vaccination-led recovery. The IMF cut India's GDP growth forecast for FY22 by as much as 3 percentage points in the July 2021 update. The hit to India's GDP has perhaps been the biggest amongst the large economies. Anubhuti, one of the reasons that the IMF has given for this is inadequate levels of vaccination. Now, how crucial will vaccination rates be to getting economies back on track? And given the current pace of India's vaccination drives, what should we expect in terms of revival timelines?
In terms of vaccination, I think the most important question to which we need to find an answer to is, what is the critical threshold of vaccination coverage which any country has to achieve in order to reduce vulnerabilities to future waves? There is a fair bit of a debate on that. With the Alpha variant, which was the prevalent variant during the first wave, the threshold for vaccination coverage, after which vulnerability is reduced significantly, was considered at 70%. Now that number has gone up to 90%. So a key factor to watch out is vaccination coverage, but we also need to keep eye on the critical threshold, which might shift in case if there are even more deadlier variants emerging over next few quarters or few years. As far as India is concerned, our baseline view is that even if we continue with the current pace, there has been an improvement. There, from 3.8 million doses, which was the average for July, we are now back towards above 4 million doses. Not where the government actually projected, but still there is an improvement from 1 month to the other. Our sense is that achieving 45 to 50% of total vaccination coverage by end of December 21 and 70% of vaccination coverage by end of March 22 looks feasible. Having said that, I think there are a few other issues which need to be kept an eye on, that, and that is vaccine hesitancy. When we are projecting 50% or 70% critical threshold being met, we are focusing a lot more on supply. and which we think will keep on easing because government efforts are pretty strong on that front. But if we look at the vaccination coverage today, especially between rural and urban areas, there is a big gap. Almost every, you know, almost 45 out of 100 people in urban area have a vaccine, you know, have received vaccine or at least one dose. In rural, that number falls all the way down to 25. And in India, the rural population is very, very large.
All right, then Jeremy, I'm going to ask you to draw some global comparisons for us as well. How has vaccine optimism really worked in some of the other economies? And how much have vaccination rates really impacted economic growth revival and consumer sentiment revival? Give us some examples, say, between India and other emerging economies or even more developed economies.
Yeah, vaccinations still remain, I think, quite key to growth recovery outlooks around the world. And what we've seen is places with very high vaccine coverage, such as Europe and North America, we have seen consumer confidence come back. We have seen consumption rise from its lows over the winter months in that area. Now, we are seeing more recently a bit of a headwind in terms of a rise in caseloads, given the Delta resurgence that we're seeing there. You know, I think one factor to take into account, though, is, you know, what this means. While we're seeing infections rise, we aren't seeing as significant of an increase in hospitalizations and death rate. And so that's allowed governments to be a little more confident in keeping restrictions less tight than they did during previous waves.
Right, fair enough. Okay, Karthik, you know, beyond the pandemic, is India's medium-term GDP growth outlook likely to be negatively affected, especially by the renewed asset quality challenges in banks and also the liquidity issues as far as NBFCs are concerned? Are you expecting a prolonged negative impact through the year, or do you think things are set to change soon?
On the liquidity front, things are slowly settling. You know, again, we need to look at it in two silos. If you look at the banking sector liquidity, that's significantly positive. They are flush with funds. There's absolutely no issues. They, in fact, don't know what to do but park it with government securities and RBI. As far as NBFC sector is concerned, which is, again, a very important constituent as far as the overall financial market is concerned, they've had their challenges on the liability side for some time now. Things have improved quite significantly from a couple of years back, but still there are challenges for some of them to raise large volumes at fine rates. So the market is still a bit polarized in terms of whom they want to lend and whom they do not want to lend.
All right. On that note, we'll head into a short break right now, but the conversation continues right here on India on the Move Season 5 exclusively on CNBC TV 18.
Standard Chartered and CNBC TV 18 present India on the Move, the 21st Century Agenda, Season 5. Standard Chartered and CNBC TV 18 present India on the Move, the 21st Century Agenda, Season 5.
Welcome back. You are watching India on the Move, Season 5 on CNBC TV 18. And on the show today, we are talking about India's macroeconomic growth outlook. Anubhuti, I want to begin this segment by talking to you a little bit about the latest developments with respect to the RBI's Monetary Policy Committee. Amidst slow growth and steeply rising inflation, the repo rate has been left untouched. What do you make of that now?
So three parts to the answer, Ridhu. First of all, on inflation, I think as far as RBI is concerned, we completely agree with RBI that it's driven by supply-led factors. It's not demand-driven. We say so because if you look at the average inflation and look at the incremental inflationary pressure between, for FY21 vis-a-vis FY20, 55 to 60% of the inflation increase is primarily coming on the back of taxes on retail fuel prices, liquor, supply-led disruptions due to COVID, including on global commodity prices like palm oil. And of course, there is some bit of pressure coming from higher global crude oil prices. Given that the demand side pressure on prices is not yet strong, we believe that inflationary pressures might start fading away once we move into FY23. Hence, we agree with RBI's view that this can be transitory. On the growth part, where RBI and MPC have been reiterating meeting after meeting that as long as they do not achieve sustainable growth recovery, they will keep the monetary policy accommodative. I think that's a very, very right approach and something which we are seeing for other central banks too.
Right, and speaking of that policy normalization, Karthik, I want you to weigh in on that as well. You know, what is this going to mean for the Indian banking sector? Anupati just laid out that roadmap for the middle of the next financial year. What do you make of it?
We largely agree with that. Our in-house view is no immediate action on the repo rates. We could see hikes in repo rate in the last quarter of the current financial year and possibly in the first quarter of next financial year, probably slightly earlier than what Anubhuti is expecting. But again, it depends on how the inflation numbers really plays out over the next couple of months. While the RBI continues to remain accommodative and supportive for growth, I do not think that they would let go of the inflation numbers. So that would be quite important as far as what monetary actions the RBI takes. From a bank's point of view, liquidity is good, so not too much of issues on that front. As interest rates start going up, they would need to mind their bond portfolio. I mean, this quarter, last year to a large extent, a declining interest rates did help them on their overall profitability metrics. And in case interest rates were to go up sometime next calendar year, that's something which banks would need to manage.
Right. So while we are talking about policy measures, one of the reasons why the IMF has been dialing down on India's GDP growth forecast is that India's policy support for the economy has not lasted as long as it has in some of the developed nations. Jeremy, I want you to comment on that. The IMF has said that most of the fiscal measures, for India were limited to the year 2020, while in more developed economies, much more support continues. How would you chart the way forward then for India on this policy front?
We have seen an unprecedented level of fiscal support around the world. And India, we have seen, of course, last year a fair bit of fiscal support as well, though a bit more constrained certainly than what we saw in developed markets. And I think the key reason for that is just that India came into the pandemic with a bit less fiscal space, certainly in our view, than many other sovereigns. And so that's made the government a little more judicious, I suppose, in how they roll out fiscal stimulus measures. That being said, we did see a decent level of support last year, and we do expect some continued support this year, although certainly the bulk of the measures are rolling off. I think going forward, the government is probably looking to balance still being supportive of growth through fiscal policy while keeping an eye towards narrowing the fiscal deficit, and that's a challenging trade-off for the government. I think some key issues that they'll have to focus on, or that what will be key to focus on is the just the targeting and the efficiency of the fiscal spending, and are you targeting the spending towards the areas that have the most impact in terms of vulnerable households and sectors in the economy. And then secondly, the government has announced its plans to roll out more significant levels of infrastructure CapEx spending. And in our view, that could have more of a positive impact on the growth outlook. I think really key to that will be implementation of that infrastructure spending and whether the government can keep those targets in place while balancing some of the other spending needs that they have. I should mention that one supporting factor is certainly the more robust levels of tax buoyancy that we're seeing relative to what we were expecting and relative to what the government was expecting in their last budget. And so that does provide a bit of a cushion in terms of allowing the government to provide a bit more in the way of fiscal spending while keeping the deficit more in line with their budget targets from last year.
All right. So, Jeremy, finally, you know, what lessons do you think India can really draw from some of the other economies as far as the shape and the speed of recovery is concerned? And how concerned should we really be about the high level of government debt to GDP and the inflation rate vis-a-vis other emerging markets?
Yeah, on the debt level and inflation front, so the public debt level in India is quite high at around 90% under the general government debt definition. And this is the highest among our EM triple B rated sovereigns. So clearly this is a bit of an outlier. India is a bit of an outlier in this regard. And so that's one of the key reason why we have India's triple B minus rating on negative outlook is to reflect, you know, given this much higher debt to GDP ratio, we still have a fair bit of uncertainty over the trajectory of that ratio. And what we would really like to see from a ratings perspective is the debt ratio go more on a downward trajectory.
All right. Anubhuti, you want to add on to that sovereign outlook that Jeremy just shared?
Sure, Ridhu. Completely agree with Jeremy on his points about high debt to GDP levels and a possibility of fiscal deficit remaining wider than the pre-pandemic levels for next few years. Having said that, I think there are two points which we need to keep in mind, at least from our perspective, from ratings outlook. First is the external sector. I think the external sector buffers for India are very, very strong. RBI has more than 600 billion of OPEX reserves, and that provides them with a lot of ammunition to handle a period of massive risk aversion.
All right, all very valuable inputs there from each of you. Thank you very much for joining us here on India on the Move. That's a wrap on this edition of the show. We'll be back with lots more next time. Thank you very much for joining us. Goodbye.
Standard Chartered and CNBC TV 18%, India on the Move, the 21st Century Agenda, Season 5. Focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable.